underdog Sligo tried to stop Mayo from winning five in a row, only achieved once before in history by Galway in the late 50s. Commentary on this one from Tom Carr and Ger Canning.
The history seekers from Mayo show two changes from the team which defeated Galway in Salt Hill. Ger Cafferkey comes into the full back line, replacing Chris Barrett, while Donald Vaughan is in for the injured Kevin Kane. Andy Moran is today seeking his eighth winner's medal. The Sligo management is reasonably chuffed by the nature of their semi-final win over Roscommon. Christor Davey was black-carded in that match and replaced by Brian Curran. And it's Curran who's been given the place at wing forward today alongside captain Mark Breheny, playing in his fifth Connacht final. Well, Sligo, I'm sure, realise the immensity of the challenge that's in front of them here. Free kick quickly taken down as far as Adrian Marin. And Keith Higgins is the one who, it appears, is going to be doing a marking job on Marin this afternoon. Score of a goal and 7 points, of course, against Roscommon a few weeks ago in the Connacht semi-final. Aidan O'Shea taking the free kick, laying it down along the line as far as Killian O'Connor here. Plenty of work to do for O'Connor. We know all about him. Sligo know all about him. They can't stop him. Still manages to get the kick in and puts it over the bar. And Mayo lead. 2 minutes gone.
Yeah, great score by Killian O'Connor. And probably from a free that might have been given to Sligo out the pitch. Adrian Marin a little bit unlucky. But a great score by Killian O'Connor to hold his balance and kick it over the bar with his right foot.
Once again, it's an O'Shea, but this time it's Seamus O'Shea. Older of the two brothers. Tom Parsons. Inside towards Aidan O'Shea, who drifted in. Jason Doherty laying it off. Oh, Killian O'Connor! He's got all the scores so far. He's on fire. Goal and a point. Only 4 minutes are gone. What a start from Mayo.
Oh dear, for Sligo. And it was all came from a high ball on top of Aidan O'Shea, who has now moved from midfield to half forward and into the full forward line. He wasn't contested with the ball. It came down, it was put away, and O'Connor is.
Dreadful start and a dreadful kick out as well, straight to Tom Parsons, who now lives in County Sligo, I believe. David O'Connor here, trying to get away from two markers, succeeding, and they're absolutely just tearing through the Sligo cover, such as it is.
And need to score badly.
Well, the worst possible start. Neil Ewing went down with an injury. It also bought a few seconds for his team. Oh, to try and get organised. They can't get outside the 20-metre line. Aidan O'Shea. He's got a point and not a goal. Oh, score. But back come Mayo again. They're all over. They're just laying siege. Seamus O'Shea this time.
Oh, dear, sir. The floodgates have opened momentarily, but it's certainly setting the scene for the rest of the game or the rest of this half. You just don't know what Sligo can do now except fight and battle the way they normally and traditionally do. But this game is...
Seamus O'Shea, and he's done it in the opening 6 minutes, and again Sligo unable to get the ball out even after their own 45, and that is another score, and that one is tapped over the bar here by Dermot O'Connor once again, his second championship goal. Killian O'Connor now has this very easy tap over, and a goal. Tommy carried on here strongly. Niall Murray hitting it, and has that one gone over the bar? It has gone over the bar. Good point by Niall Murphy, and Murphy getting his first point today, his third ever in the championship.
Stars and everybody is standing. It's aimed towards the defence.
Great catch that time, taken down brilliantly, commandingly by Tom Parsons. Looks ahead of him now, sees plenty of movement. Aidan O'Shea at full forward, always the target. Got a new marker here now. McDonald tried to mark him, but Aidan O'Shea clips it over the bar.
Tighter game. Letting the ball a bit loose, even though O'Shea taking two or three attempts to pick up the ball. Sligo not able to capitalise on that.
Pat Hughes down there, two against one, and the one is one at David Kelly. Lays it off here, Marin, and that's another point for Sligo.
And if Kelly could have just retained that the first time, he would have gone inside, because he will go for goal, no doubt about it. He had to come back, a little bit of a slip, thought about it, but Marin came in and probably should have gone for goal.
Adrian Marin. And once again, Mayo are able to build. That time, Killian O'Connor back, the provider. Andy Moran looking ahead towards the one-man inside forward line. And once again, it's Aidan O'Shea here holding off Brendan Egan and everybody else. Jason Doherty then, and Doherty's kick, the umpires agree, is a good one, and that's gone over and raises a white flag. And ball rolling it up towards Andy Moran. And coming across to get the boot in was Daniel May. Now UK born. Came to Sligo with his family at an early age, and right now he's watching. That ball is put in the back of the net by Aidan O'Shea. And the two O'Sheas have scored goals here in the opening 21 minutes.
Well, it's exhibition stuff, Jared, there's no doubt about it. And the exhibition being given by Mayo, and specifically by Aidan O'Shea, in terms of winning ball, holding players off, taking scores. It's a one-man show up there at the minute, and being very well supported by the rest of the Mayo players out the pitch. Technical things that they shouldn't be doing.
Here's Marin, however. Adrian Marin fisting this one and putting it over the bar. Seamus O'Shea easily picking out Jason Doherty here. Throw of the shoulders, then off he goes. Inside to Donald Vaughan from the 20-metre line. He fancies getting his name among the scorers as well.
Very difficult to have the motivation in this game. You just don't see the end, and another score for Sligo.
Kenny there has given wonderful service to Sligo over the years. Brendan Egan, his brother, is among the subs. Chipped down once again towards Pat Hughes. Now he is in that inside forward line. Egan has stayed up there, trying to get beyond, and he cracks it in.
Yes, I think it's a goal, Jared. It certainly went on the inside of the post.
Brendan Egan, first time he has ever scored a goal in the Championship. He decided to take the game by the scruff of the neck here and just fire it in once he had cast aside the challenge of Jason Doherty, in off the angle of the post and in.
Yeah, it's
there, number six, Brendan Egan. Andy Moran now. Carried on with determination here by Barry Moran. He's been watching the others. And there is yet another one for Aidan O'Shea.
Well, I think that's certainly another nail in the coffin. A coffin that has been firmly shut at this stage. And the fact that Mayo can take off. Yeah, great run, a great pass. And again, it's typical, Jared, the team. He wasn't...
Kevin McLaughlin. And again, Donald Vaughan joins the attack. Awkward enough angle, so it's back as far as Killian O'Connor again. Twice Young Footballer of the Year, as we know. Tom Parsons has come back into the Championship team this year. Spins around. Still has a support player outside there in Dean O'Connor. Back into Barry Bowen, and they fist it over the bar this time. Still here, trying to build a little bit of momentum. Try and get themselves into another scoring opportunity. Free kick, which Niall Murphy's going to take. Well, they had one man waiting for it. It was Pat Hughes, who was making a run, and they didn't hit the ball down to him quickly enough. Instead, it's to Mark Breheny. Breheny doing what he's often done in the past, hitting from about 35 metres out, and this time he drops it onto the post and over. Good point by Mark Breheny.
Hard for the scores that they're getting, Jared. It's just going to sap their energy out. In fact, the situation will probably only get worse because they have to work so hard to win the ball. And even look at that kick out there. There's not a soul within sight of the kicker whatsoever. Their reaction to kickouts is so slow.
1 minute of additional time is going to be played. Into Aidan O'Shea. Danger once again. Killian O'Connor and O'Shea, and the goalkeeper tips it over. Aidan Devaney helps it over. Had to do
4 goals and 9 points. To 1 goal and 6. And that is a rundown through it, and it's rare to see as many goals against fellas' names as you will see points from that first half. A couple of people around here asking me at half time if I'm feeling okay. There's more life in me than there is, I'm afraid, out there in that pitch at the moment.
Yeah, but unfortunately, Michael, it's
that's not saying a lot.
Listen, the game is over, as we know. We said before the game, Mayo are operating at a different level, and that's what's come true. Now, you got to look at it from a Sligo perspective. You're damned if you do, and you're damned if you don't. You know, the first 10-15 minutes of any game when you're playing as the underdog is the most important. And you look at what Westmeath done against Dublin last week. They came and they made, at least they made life difficult. They asked him a few questions.
Yeah.
But Sligo, very naive. They knew Aidan O'Shea was going to play at the edge of the square. They knew they had problems in their full back line. And Mayo have just gone to town on them, physically in a different league. And you just hope that Sligo can hang in there, because it has potential to be a disaster for Sligo.
Yeah, you talked about this actually, Colin, before the match, about the lack of physicality in that Sligo side. And that is part of their problem, as Kieran said.
Yeah, and Mayo had their work done and they were ruthless in their execution. They realised Sligo were going to have difficulty with the kickouts. They pushed up in the beginning, forced Aidan Devaney to kick, intercepted quite a few of them, and it's shooting fish in a barrel time. It's a proper championship contenders against a third division team. And if you're to take Mayo, Dublin, Kerry, probably the top three teams in the country, and a team like Mayo just ruthlessly dismantles a team who are operating at a lower level. And I feel sorry for Sligo. But the only cause for concern from a Mayo point of view, they've scored 1-6 against them.
Like the old failings are still there.
Monaghan scored 8 points in the Ulster final. We're winning at half-time. Sligo score 1-6 in the Connacht final and the game is over.
Look, Michael, it is men against boys. It's a Division 1 team playing a Division 3 team. In the world of Gaelic football, the strong gobble up the weak. I mean, Einstein said in explaining the theory of insanity, the definition of insanity is where you keep doing the same thing over and over again and you expect different results. Well, Sligo have that, putting that theory of insanity in place in that first half, because the insanity
impact on the game at this stage. That's a huge one down all the way to Jason Doherty. Nobody marking him. Absolutely nobody able to get to him initially, and that was enough for him to make a lot of ground and to kick first 45 up into the air, accurately dispatched and nicely put over the bar. Lee Keegan. Nobody able to challenge Lee Keegan effectively. Donal Vaughan once again onto the 20-metre line. Two defenders involved in that, and a move set off by Keith Higgins. And finally put over the bar by Donal Vaughan, who's got a second for the day. And it's 4-12 to 1-6.
Yeah, and has been playing up there all day, really has been up.
And again, may our Sligo persist with just the short kick out, and then it's so hard to work it through the different channels to get it forward, but they get it up as far as Neil Ewing this time. In from the flanks, inside towards David Kelly, that's livelier. Back out as far as Adrian Maron. Maron kicking it with the right and kicking it beautifully over the bar. Gives it back to the younger O'Connor, and off his boot this time. That is remarkably well done. Dermot O'Connor steering. Usually sits in the stand and observes what's happening. Right now he's observing Kian Brehany causing a few problems for his defenders and score a very nice point indeed. Long ball in towards Aidan O'Shea, and onto it again comes Dermot O'Connor, challenged, and the challenge by Owen Flanagan wasn't strong enough, and it was booted over. Keegan adventurously hitting it down once again. That probing kick is down to Aidan O'Shea once again, and Aidan O'Shea 13 minutes into the second half. Killian O'Connor with a goal and two goals and, was it one goal and four? One goal and four for Killian O'Connor. And now one goal and five. Fourth round qualifier. A Tyrone side that are gathering momentum ominously from the rest of the chasing pack. Once again, Aidan O'Shea. And Aidan O'Shea boots this one neatly inside the right-hand upright. Beaten in several big games and they felt awful about it, and right now they can understand how Sligo are feeling, but not that this man worries about that, because Aidan O'Shea has got a hat-trick.
You could see it happening. He stepped back behind his man, waiting for the floated ball, the most dangerous ball in Gaelic football, from there, right across to there, watching stick back, come forward, take the his own break and sticks it away. He had nothing to do once he came down with that ball. What a great score by Aidan O'Shea. What a great display by Aidan O'Shea.
Well, he's playing like a giant among the little people, and he's made it 5-17 to 1-8, 32.4, who has come on, and that's Mark Ronaldson.
Well, they're so comfortable, Ger, they can take their time bringing on a replacement, and they can wait a few minutes if needs be, but yeah, they'll give everybody a run as much as they can, and even Sligo will start to do the same thing.
Aidan O'Shea again has the option of laying it off to Killian O'Connor. They've got six. Free kick which Mark Rennie is going to take from just outside the 20-metre line. They may need to do so at some future stage, but right now they can just enjoy Aidan O'Shea having a field day. And that is now 3 goals and 4 points.
And I think at this stage...
Martin now. Sending it up there towards Hughes, and he's caught it as well. Pat Hughes scores! Second goal for Sligo. Pat Hughes with his second ever goal in the championship. 55 minutes are gone, quarter of an hour to go.
And the reason he scored that was because he has the physicality to hold off men and to drive through with the ball, but he's the only one on that Sligo forward line, even though Kelly has been very good and very industrious, but he had the physicality, and you needed at certain stages in the game speed. And
Owen McHugh looking for it here, and that was finally dropped in there dangerously and fisted over the bar here, and giving it to Patrick Durkin. Alan Dillon once again replaced Andy Moran for the second half. Mark Ronaldson has a goal and scores.
Comparing the two,
Alan Dillon makes an angle, then cuts inside. Dillon fisting, and they're not just prepared. Patrick Durkin. And Durkin has now got himself a Connacht final point as well.
And I think that's all that was on his mind when he was sold on Rock.
Once again, we're seeing Alan Dillon in the centre of things, giving it off to Killian O'Connor. And this time he's wide. Again, and the big man has it. Laying it off and booted over the bar by substitute Chris Barrett. Booted in here towards David Kelly. Collecting it instead is Pat Hughes. Laying it off to Breheny, and that flashes over the bar from Mark Breheny's boot. Third phase to this year, this season, because the league was very competitive with all Division 1 teams, obviously, as that's hit in and hit over the bar from Mark Rollins, and he's got a second. 23 years of age, playing his 21st championship match this afternoon, and he rounds off this facile, easy win with the new management team, Pat Holmes, Noel Kennelly, commiserating with Niall Carew of Sligo. Sligo were very firmly out of their depth, and in Aidan O'Shea, Mayo had an absolute star this evening. He got 3 goals and 4 points. Poor Aidan Devaney beaten. So this is what it's all about. Keith Higgins is the captain. The Nestor Cup goes back to Mayo. They have trounced Sligo by all of 26 points this afternoon. They've done the 5 in a row. Mayo are the champions in the West once again.
Yeah, look, it's very disappointing. I suppose the gap and the gulf was there in terms of, you know, the top 4 or 5 teams. You know, we would have set up the way we set up against Roscommon, but just didn't happen for us today. And I suppose we needed a start that Mayo got. And as an underdog, then you lose quite a bit of energy and confidence then. So we struggled. But look, we have to pick up the pieces again. We have a game in 2 weeks, and we certainly would have learned a hell of a lot from today.
Where does that leave Mayo now in terms of the All-Ireland Championship?
In exactly the same position as Monaghan. We're into the quarterfinals, the same as Dublin.
Yes, but they have these competitive games behind them, don't they? And that is something that has proved a problem for you and for Dublin as well in the past.
Maybe so. Look, you know, at the end of the day, we go out and you play the teams, you know, that you're up against. We play Galway in the semi-final, we played Sligo today. We're now in the quarterfinal. That's where we wanted to be at the start of the year. And yeah, we'll plan for that, and we'll work hard and hopefully bring another big performance in 3 weeks' time.
Yeah, well, it was a big performance. 6-25 is a hell of a scoreline. But, Kevin, expand on that a little bit. There was a goal from class, as Niall Carew said. Did Mayo gain a lot from the match, in your view?
It's a good question. It ended up as a run-out. But, say, in as you were approaching the game from a couple of months back, Mayo trekking out, where was the season going to go? They got to the final, totally expected to be in the final. They expected, yes, they did. Do they expect to be in the quarterfinal? That's all part of the planning process for them. They would have been absolutely certain in their minds, their belief, that they would come out of Connacht, no matter whether it was Galway, Roscommon or Sligo. That's for sure. That it turned out to be a bit of a rout today is unfortunate. Certainly very unfortunate for Sligo, because, you know, they were a little bit humiliated, I thought. There was a serious gulf, tackling, tempo, all the things that we know the top four have the gap on the rest. But I don't think it's necessarily, you know, nothing in it for Mayo today. I mean, it's their ticket to the quarterfinals. They should, because they're champions now, get a reasonable draw out of the round four side of it. So they can be almost thinking in their heads now, we hit a bit of form, we have three matches left to win this All-Ireland that we can't get our hands on. Three matches left to do it. Quarterfinal, not too bad, all things considered. And then if you get to the fence beyond that, well, anyone can win the All-Ireland from then on.
I mean, it was pretty ruthless in a way. 6.25 could have been a bit more even,
yes,
goal-wise.
Well, 26-point win in a provincial final. I think the longest winning streak of all the teams, like, you know, 5 years, over 5 years. It's an incredible record that they have. But, like, the thing that through the league, I kind of felt myself that they've been kind of quiet. Since there's not much happening in Mayo. Like, Pat Holmes and Noel Kennelly have done a good job in kind of lowering the expectations. But just today, I think they're starting to prepare to write the songs again, because it was such a good performance. It was, you know, like Aidan O'Shea, the performance he's put in. But, like, the thing is, they need to just calm it down again, refocus, and, like, go forward, because there will be big obstacles, and they have shown their hand a small bit today.
A friend of mine texted me and said, I fear the hope is rising again.
not for the team, it won't. That team is so road-tested. Hype and that stuff won't.
You can't blame the fans.
Of course, there's a lot of very impressive elements. This is a quest that this county have been on for, you know, 70 years nearly at this stage, whatever it is. So, no, that won't affect the team. They'll be insulated from
that. OK, Eamon, you know, a proud Sligo man. It was very disappointing for Sligo and the goodwill and great support they had. How do you react to it?
Yeah, it's just bitterly disappointed. As I think, you know, the lead up to the game, you know, beating Roscommon was fantastic. It was a fantastic achievement, albeit that it wasn't expected by a lot of people. And I think going into this game, you know, I felt personally myself it was going to be a big ask. I thought Mayo was going to win the game, but not in the style that they did. And unfortunately, after 5 minutes, just heads dropped. Sligo heads dropped. And, you know, guys tried hard. Ross Donovan in particular, you know, he fought a lone battle back there at times in the full back position. But overall, Mayo's class was outstanding. Yeah. Now, Mayo, like Desi alluded to there, but they've gone 5 years now. This is possibly their easiest game in those last 5 years. Like, they played London in a Connacht final, and, you know, London probably put up a better performance. But I'm just disappointed with the lads, because I know how hard they've worked. And Niall has done a great job with them. He's, you know, he's found a system. But I just think today the system just didn't work. You know, he probably should have, you know, I snagged people about a Roscommon bus on social media.
Do you want to apologize?
I probably would have. Yeah. I probably, you know, they probably should have parked a bus. But it should have been a case of that, keep themselves in the game up to half time. But after 3 minutes, 4 minutes.
I think that's what Westmeath did last week. And there was a feeling
against Dublin.
Yeah, exactly. Westmeath did that last week. They played a provincial final. Everyone knew that Dublin were going to win the game effectively. But at the same time, up to half time, just after, until the goals went in, there was a feeling like that Westmeath actually did quite well.
Yeah. All right, then, it's a difficult one. Let's look at those first five.
And in a midfield today, he worked exceptionally hard, and Desi pointed out a lot of those facts there today. The second man that I went for was the powerhouse and the scoring machine, Aidan O'Shea. Again, tremendous performance again from him. And the third man was the young O'Connor. We went for Dermot O'Connor. He was outstanding as well. He chipped in and showed, you know, caveats of what his brother has been doing over the last couple of years.
Okay. And who gets it then?
Well, Finian Hanley still wakes up with nightmares about this man. He was incredible against Galway. He was incredible again today. He scored 3 goals and 4 points, all from play. Aidan O'Shea.
Okay. Not the first time, I think, that the big fella has won the award. He spoke with Joanne afterwards.
Hey, Dunshay, congratulations today. You're enjoying that role in full forward, aren't you?
Yeah, look, today went well again, I suppose. Have to thank the boys out the field. We got some quality ball in today, and thankfully we got the ball rolling early on, and I got a few chances. I probably should have stuck another one early in the first half, but nice in there today.
Do you think you'll adapt the way you play and the type of game you play as you go on and you come up against stiffer opposition?
Yeah, look, we'll have to adapt. It depends on who we're playing, I suppose, and where Pat and Noel feel where to play me, I suppose, depends on the game and the opposition and what strengths and weaknesses they have. So I suppose we'll depend on who we play. We'll have to see where I play.
Well, it was a hat-trick of goals you got today, so well done. Aidan, that is why you are the Super Value RT Man of the Match, and Cecil Whiteside from Super Value is here with your award.
Here to help meet your little one's iron needs as part of a healthy diet. Find out more at smamums.ie.
You can quit and we can help. Call 1-800-201-203, text QUIT to 500.